Good afternoon, everybody. You know, one of the genuine pleasures of serving as the director of the Du Bois Institute is co-hosting with our board chair, Glenn Hutchins, this annual panel discussion at this historic, magnificent Old Wailing Church right here in Edgartown. Now, we've been doing this for more than 15 years, and it's become an annual summertime ritual, and I have to say that I look forward to it every year. The Du Bois Institute, if you're ever in Cambridge, come to Harvard Square, 20,000 square feet, right in the heart of Harvard Square. It's got the Hutchins Family Library, the Image of the Black and Western Art Archive and Library, the Henry and Celia McGee Black Film Poster Collection. We have 15 fellows that come from all over the world to be in residence, from Asia and Africa, Europe, and of course the United States. And we have a $53 million endowment. It's a leading research center, center of teaching and scholarship about the entire black world, the black world in Europe, in Africa, the Caribbean, Latin America, and here, of course, in the United States. And it is what it has become because of our very loyal National Advisory Board and the leadership of the chair of that board. So I want to give a special welcome to our board members who are either here or are coming. And when I call your name, please stand up. Bennett Ashley. As Bennett. Carol Biondi. She's coming, she's not here. Richard Cohen, did Richard make it? He's not here yet. Mitch and Frida Kapoor. Give it up for Mitch and Frida. Michael Linton. Michael Linton right there. A guy I grew up with in Piedmont, West Virginia, Mark Mamlin. I've known that boy for 60 years. Doug Schoen, is Doug Schoen here? Not yet. My Yale classmate, Larry Thompson, on his way. And finally, Davis Weinstock. Now, I want to give a special thanks to the chair of our board, my co-host of this annual event, my dear friend, more like a brother, and that's Glenn Hutchins. Glenn Hutchins is endlessly imaginative, energetic, giving and loving, generous with his time, his ideas, his resources, generous, some people might say, to a fault. If there's one reason why the Du Bois Institute thrives and flourishes, it's because of Glenn Hutchins' leadership of our board. More than anyone else I know in the entire American Academy, ladies and gentlemen, Glenn Hutchins walks the walk for African American studies. Give it up to my man, Glenn Hutchins. Now, our topic this year is separate but unequal, closing the education gap, and it is moderated once again by the remarkable Charlene Hunter Gault. Now, before I introduce Charlene properly, let me say just a few words about the crisis in education in the black community. A recent report just done in June by the College Board found that one out of every two young men of color, aged 15 to 24, who graduates from high school is going to end up unemployed, incarcerated, or dead. One out of two, ladies and gentlemen. And that's among those who graduate. And what about those who drop out? What are their chances at subsistence, a meaningful, decent life? Ladies and gentlemen, how did this happen to our people? When I was growing up in the 50s and 60s, you all know what I'm talking about. The blackest thing that you could be was an educated man or woman, not an entertainer or an athlete. Our people have valued education, starting with mastering the ABCs since slavery, when, as Frederick Douglass put it, our ancestors had to steal a little learning from the white man. What's happened to the role of education within our community and to the public educational system in black communities? I remember a time when teachers in the black community had almost a godlike presence, and our public schools were sanctuaries, communal sites of hope and aspiration. How much of the crisis is a result of structural forces, and how much, if any, is a result of behavioral issues, matters of attitude? And what do we do about this? Well, one thing is certain. There is no more pressing need facing our people, and we need the equivalent of a civil rights movement, a new civil rights movement, to confront it, to confront the relationship between poor educational opportunity and poor education and poor jobs, jobs so-called destined to keep people poor and their children poor. Despite the fact that the black middle class has grown dramatically since 1968, and those of us gathered here are examples of that, those of us who have benefited from affirmative action, despite the fact by some estimates that the black middle class has quadrupled since that terrible day when Dr. King was killed, the percentage of black children living at or beneath the poverty line is about 35%. Guess what it was the day Martin Luther King was killed? About 35%. And our public schools, all too many of them, have fallen apart. Who could have imagined this in 1968? Dr. King didn't die to see a small percentage of us make it, while the larger percentage of our people remain mired in this cycle of poverty. What can we do about this? What does education have to do with this? Well, that's what we've gathered here together this afternoon to discuss under the stewardship of the great Charlene Hunter Gull. And now let me introduce her. Charlene is an award-winning journalist who's not only worked in but also reshaped the news industry for more than four decades. The first American reporter for The New Yorker, the first African-American reporter for The New Yorker, and the second for The New York Times, she first came to national attention as the subject of a news story herself, and we all remember 1961 when she and Hamilton Holmes were the first black students admitted to the University of Georgia after a series of court challenges, exhaustive media attention, and violent demonstrations on the Athens campus. Her path-breaking career in journalism, as I said, began at The New Yorker and The Times. She became then one of the most influential figures in television news, where she was a chief national correspondent for the McNeil-Lehrer Report and the Johannesburg bureau chief and correspondent for CNN. She served as chief correspondent in Africa for NPR, where she remains special correspondent. She also contributes frequently, I'm pleased to say, pieces on Africa for TheRoot.com. Among our numerous awards and distinctions in 1986, Charlene was named Journalist of the Year by the National Association of Black Journalists, who inducted her into its Hall of Fame in the year 2005. Charlene is the author of the memoir In My Place and New News Out of Nowhere, Uncovering Africa's Renaissance. Charlene Hunter Gault, ladies and gentlemen, is a history maker who became an historian. And she is one of my most respected colleagues and dearest friends. Give it up for Charlene Hunter Gault.
Thank you so much, Skip. I guess that's the down payment for my participation next year. You know, every year for the past few years, it's been my pleasure to take part in this event. But I think this is the first time that I have felt so personally and viscerally connected to a theme. As you heard from Skip, this past January, I traveled to Athens, Georgia, to commemorate the 50th anniversary of my desegregation of the University of Georgia, along with my late classmate, Hamilton Holmes. 50 years ago, in 1961, we were excited that the deferred dream of the 1954 Brown decision was finally becoming a reality. The judge who ordered us into the University of Georgia also opened the door to desegregation of the public schools in Atlanta that would take place the following fall of 1961, and that we hopefully thought would end the lie of separate but equal. But alas, not only in Georgia, but across this land, the dream of equal education remains a dream deferred, if not a nightmare. And we are going to look at the whys of that today and the possibility of restoring the dream and delivering on the promise of Brown. As usual, we have a fabulous panel, and this year, a very special guest who comes to us by way of the White House Evening of Poetry and Music, where he displayed his talents to someone who is, I think, landing right about now. And he showed them, as he will show us today, his talents as a spoken word artist, where he will, I'm sure, get the same kind of reception that he got at the White House. He is Joshua Bennett, whose dream was not deferred as he graduated Phi Beta Kappa and magna cum laude from the University of Pennsylvania in 2010. And among his many accomplishments, he also has a book of poetry called Jesus Riding Shotgun. Ladies and gentlemen, Joshua Bennett.
Thank you so much. Can everyone hear me? You sure? Okay. Now I know y'all are real like educated folk, but I need some energy today. So who here has seen spoken word poetry before? Can you raise your hand? Oh, okay. So most of you guys. So when you hear something you like, what do? You make noise, right? You snap, clap, okay. Cool, are y'all following? All right, whatever, it's fine. We're gonna have a good time. So when I was first asked to do this event, I thought about, I guess, what it means to have lived the better part of my life knowing what the education gap looks like, if not having had the language to call it that. I've been a teaching artist for about the past 4 years, and this first poem I'm gonna do for you guys is called Derek, and it's about my experience at Penn, where I was part of a program called the Ashe Academy, where every Saturday morning we would have kids from West Philly come in, and from about 9 a.m. to 3 p.m, we would do reading and math exercises with them. And I had the same mentee from the time I was 18 to the time I was 21. His name was Derek Pratt, brilliant young man. But clearly, I think the educational system he was a part of failed him in some very serious ways. But Derek taught me a lot about why I want to teach and why it's important that everyone that's on this panel is here today, because our children matter. And I'm really thankful for the opportunity. So this first piece is called Derek. I hope you enjoy. Derek and I play basketball on weekends. He's a citywide champion, and I'm not very good, but he still lets me win sometimes. Claims that he's had more girlfriends than me. We both know how impossible this is, but I give him the benefit of the doubt, like an overlooked foul call during a championship game, and I wonder if he's so adept at dribbling because he's never been very good at holding on to anything for too long. He never travels, has never really left West Philly, so we imagine our kneecaps as jet engines to propel us from the athletic to the imaginary without a second thought. See, Derek never carries anything but his hopes and dreams in that single folder in his knapsack, scarring words onto pages until ink drops like blood onto the concrete of his composition notebook, and his words become a no-look pass to his past. While I'm able to imagine a 13-year-old boy with astronomical dreams but a 10-foot mindset. See, he's scared to shoot for the moon for fear that he might wound her, because the same hands that win games have also cracked ribs and broken jawbones, because in school, Derek fights as hard as he plays, and I want to get him to take out that anger on standardized tests and break down barriers through his grades. Show him that the triangle offense isn't so different from the triangular trade, as I tell him tales of the Middle Passage and how Allen Iverson's braids would have been a cornrowed map to freedom back in slavery days. It's a history lesson taking place in the middle of a park, and I want him to be more vulnerable, but he's got a hardwood heart and a culture of violence egging him on from the bleachers. These children choose blacktop over blackboards, give up grade school for gats, and clap each other like backboards. It's a game they know they are destined to lose. But when Derek jumps, you would swear that rusted orange rim becomes a halo, hanging majestically above his angelic adolescent body left wingless by the guillotine eyes of his seventh grade teachers who never taught him how to coax pictures from the page until imagination is forced to jump off the bench and play by the rules of Derek's game. He just wants to read as hard as he plays, stutter step stereotype, and change the way everyone sitting in the stands seems to view him. And I pray that he never trades jump shots for gunshots, becomes a shooting guard who shoots at cars instead of baskets, arcing bodies through the air until they swish into caskets, and he's Jordan in his prime, 45 on his back, frozen in time, posterized to the pavement, because I couldn't promise him that mathematics would make him a millionaire. But he still does his best to pay attention when I tell him that 60 years ago, people that looked like us were afraid of this world's obsession with how long we could remain suspended in the air. But Derek still stresses over his hang time. Can't understand why I beg him to remain grounded. And so until the day my skin withers the color and texture of a deflated basketball, I will always think of him. My hands will always be there as a reminder that God may not play dice, but he definitely shoots hoops. And I see him every weekend in the eyes of a 13-year-old boy with a hardwood heart, Wilt Chamberlain's smile, and chain-link fence fingers that hold this entire world in their grip. Swish.
Woo! Woo!
Okay, Joshua, you get to come back. Thank you so much. That was just what we needed to get this ball rolling. And now, for our panel, who's going to rap in a different way, Lawrence Bobo, our sage, our W.E.B. Du Bois professor of social sciences at Harvard. His most recent of many contributions to intellectual discourse was as the editor of the spring 2011 Daedalus, the Journal of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. It was an entire issue devoted to race, inequality, and culture. Michelle Rhee, who has defied the odds of the airwave shut down for the president and managed to get here in spite of all of that. And we so appreciate your effort, Michelle. Michelle is the founder and CEO of Students First, an advocacy group with the goal of promoting school reform by backing laws and political candidates. She's a former teacher with Teach for America and served as the chancellor of the Washington, D.C. public schools from 2007 to 2010. James Comer is the Maurice Falk Professor of Child Psychiatry at Yale, the Yale University School of Medicine's Child Study Center, and a familiar face to most of us Vineyarders. He created the Comer School Development Program, SDP, in 1968, and it was the forerunner of many modern school reforms. Diane Ravitch is a historian and research professor of education at New York University and a non-resident fellow at the Brookings Institution. She's a former assistant secretary of education, and her most recent book, which is off the charts, is The Death and Life of the Great American School System: How Testing and Choice Are Undermining Education. And finally, Angel Harris is an assistant professor of sociology and African American studies at Princeton University, and he is the author of a just published book, Kids Don't Fail: Oppositional Culture and the Black-White Achievement Gap. So Angel, I'd like for you to start us off with the evidence that black children in America are still bearing the burden of separate and unequal education more than a half century after the Brown decision. Tell us what's going on.
Okay, so I think that there are three reasons for the gap and the persistence of the achievement gap. One is, I think of it as, there's an incompatibility between the lens that black people view the world through and education. Now, when I say black people, I mean on average. So for example, I teach statistics at Princeton. This is a very fun course, in case you have not heard of it. It's very fun. And in this course, what happens is there's usually some anxiety, and when I'm teaching a statistical technique, the first time I go over it, some people will get it. And then I have to go to my second example because I see some puzzled looks. And on my second example, now you get it. And then sometimes I have to dig into my third and fourth example. And by then you get it. So what happens is that you all are looking at the same piece of information, right? But by virtue of the lens that you have, the way you view the world, your experience as a black woman, your experience as a white male, even your age, gender, race, class, all these things give you a lens through which you view the world. And you're looking at the same piece of information, but you're looking at it through a different set of eyes. And what happens is that there's not enough respect for the idea that we're all bringing a different set of eyes to the same problem. And so we need a new model, I guess, to... So it's a lack of taking that into account. I'll go into that later on. So that's one reason, is that there's an incompatibility between the way most disadvantaged people view the world and the way education is delivered, the current models that we have. Second is there's a lack of understanding of proportions and distributions. So what I mean by that is every characteristic has a proportion or a distribution. So for example, height. We know that there are some people who are really short. We know some people are really tall. But on average, most people are in the middle, right? But there's a distribution where you have, if you put the short people here, tall people here, most people are lumped in the middle, okay? So we have the same thing with achievement and with different characteristics. So an analogy I'll use is if you take, say, 100 people and randomly assign 100 people to Hawaii and another 100 to Kansas, and you come back 10 years later and you see which group has the highest proportion of people who can swim, right? It's gonna be people in Hawaii, right? However, there's going to be someone in Kansas who can swim really well, and people will point to that person and say, see, that person swims really well, therefore, it has nothing to do with the fact that these people are placed in Hawaii and Kansas. And so you try to build policy off of that one case. That's the one charter school that works. And then we wonder why it's not scaling up, and it's because you're picking an outlier within this distribution, and everything has a distribution. It's a lack of understanding that, and it leads us to chase ineffective policies. We spin our wheels. And finally, the third reason is depth. I don't think we respect the problem. So it's a four-year gap. So what I mean by that is, on average, the black and Latino 12th graders are graduating high school with the same skill sets that whites had in the eighth grade. So it's a four-year gap, right? So another way to think about it is, when you're sitting in college, on average, those black freshmen have eighth grade skill set, okay? Now, how is this gap changing over time? From the 60s to 2000, the gap was declining, right? But the rate of decline was really slow. Right, so if, you know, if I jump in my car and I drive 60 miles an hour, in an hour I will drive 60 miles. Given the rate of decline of the gap, if we keep moving the way we're moving, we'll arrive at our destination of total gap convergence in 60 years in reading, and in 10 decades in math. That's the projected trend given national surveys, and I'll spare you the details. But essentially, that's the general trend. That's what's happening. However, I hear, you know, different policymakers where they have this No Child Left Behind Act, right? Where they say, we're gonna close the gap by 2014. And when I hear that, I say they're really optimistic or they were unaware of these projected trends. I don't wanna think that, because I know they keep, you know, they have their ear to the streets and they understand what's going on. Or that they have a plan that they've yet to unveil. And so we're still waiting on that one. But essentially, there's a lack of respect to the problem. When I hear people say, we got to fix this within my political term, to me, that sounds like someone walking into an oncologist's office and saying, you guys have been working on cancer for years, you have a lot of money invested in this, give me the cure by next week. We wouldn't do that because we respect that problem. And so it's a lack of respect. We want to travel 60 miles in 2 minutes. And given the current rate of things, we don't have the technology to do that given the current model of education that we have. So essentially, I think the problem persists because of incompatibility, we don't understand proportions and we point to the outliers, and finally, we don't respect the problem and so we end up shooting BB guns at a freight train.
Angel has some solutions too, as do all of the members of the panel, but I've asked each one in this first go-round to give me their analysis of the problem, and then we're going to do solutions. So I'm going to now go to Diane Ravitch and ask her, from your perspective, Diane, why do we continue to have this lingering disparity?
First, I want to thank Skip Gates for inviting me. And second, I want to say that I'm old enough to remember the day that Charlene Hunter integrated the University of Georgia, and I am in awe to be here with her.
Just don't tell me you were 5 years old.
I wish. I've been a historian for 36 years, so I'm going to try to put this in some perspective. There has always been an achievement gap between white and black students for somewhat obvious reasons. This tremendous burden of our history, of generations of oppression, discrimination, and prejudice. The achievement gap is as old as our nation. It narrowed substantially in the 1970s and 1980s. There was a very good publication that came from ETS called The Black-White Achievement Gap, When Progress Stopped, analyzing the reasons why this narrowing that was very substantial then stalled. And it hasn't stopped completely, but it's certainly not been the kind of progress we saw in the 70s and 80s, so the question is why? The biggest issue is really the persistence of poverty. And I know these days that you're not supposed to say that, but it's true. You can look at any test given in the United States or in the world, whether it's the SAT, the ACT, the national assessment, which is given by the federal government, state test, there's a very tight correlation between poverty and test scores. The richest kids are at the top, the poorest kids are at the bottom. On the most recent international assessments, you've probably heard the stories about how American test scores were just terrible on the international test. In fact, in the low poverty schools in the US, the test scores were higher than in Finland, Japan, and Korea. Where the school had 25% poverty, the test scores were equivalent to Finland, Korea, and Japan, the world leaders. As the proportion of poor kids grows larger, the test scores go down. So what I think has happened, and this is not solutions, but a description, is that as more and more blacks entered the middle class and left the cities have become more intensely segregated, the city school systems have become more intensely segregated, and also more concentrated poverty. And at the same time, the manufacturing base of the cities has disappeared because of globalization. So there's very high unemployment amongst those who remain, in many cases, trapped in the inner city and in the inner city schools. And then there is this dramatic crisis of mass incarceration. Bruce Western has written about this rather eloquently. The black incarceration rate is 8 times the white incarceration rate. And in an essay that he wrote last year in a publication of the American Academy of Political and Social Science, he said, we made a decision, this society made a decision in the 60s. We could have addressed the yawning social gap between the races. Instead, we decided to build prisons. So, whether you read the work of William Julius Wilson, who writes about when work disappeared, or Bruce Western about mass incarceration, of Skip Gates about the interplay of structural and cultural factors, the fact remains that when 35% of black children are in poverty, when the national child poverty rate is 20%, and we lead the world. We lead the world in child poverty. We have a series of social and political issues that we're unwilling to face. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Diane. Jim Comer, I want you to press your little button there and get your little green light going.
Okay.
And give us your perspective on the problem, why it exists.
Thank you very much. I want to pick up the point of poverty, and I agree with it, but I want to point out something. I am the product of a child of poverty. I was born into a poor family. My mother had less than 2 years of college, of school, period, and worked as a domestic. My father, steel mill labor, and had about a sixth grade education. And yet the two of them sent the five of us to college for a total of 13 college degrees. My three best friends, who were also very poor, very bright, went on a downhill course. Same school, same situation. The difference was the quality of the developmental experience that I received at home that they did not receive at home. And so the question is how you provide that developmental experience for all, how you approximate that experience in school. Now, so you ask the question then, how do most children have school success? Think about the African-American experience that Diane mentioned a bit, and then also think about the flawed educational enterprise model of how children learn that we are operating from. And in order to have school success, most often, you have reasonable preparation for school at home, a supportive home environment, and quality school conditions. And by prepared, I mean children have interactions with all of the adult authority figures around them that give them support for brain development, functioning, social interactive skills, psycho-emotional, moral, ethical, linguistic, intellectual, cognitive. You have all of that at home, and that's what sends you to school ready to learn. But it also gives you a sense of belonging in any mainstream environment, competencies that are necessary, and also a sense of opportunity that I can achieve something. Now, let's think about the African-American experience, as mentioned. It's characterized by the actual opposite of that. There was exclusion and abuse, a determined effort to demonstrate that blacks were inferior, to destroy confidence, and deny opportunity. And all of that's in the air all the time, in the past and right now. Those factors are operating, this attempt is operating. Until the 1960s, and even now, there was no significant economic, political power in the African-American community that could challenge and stop those messages from coming directly to our children. Now, despite these conditions, many blacks developed adaptive mechanisms that made it possible for many to be successful in school and in life. And also, you could work without a good education. And as a result of that, over three generations after slavery, there was upward mobility among many. But about the 1950s, increasingly, you needed education to be able to earn a living wage. And that caused a breakdown in the adaptive mechanisms, an increase in the number of dysfunctional or differently functioning families. In other words, they couldn't prepare their children for the mainstream. As a result of that, many families were unable to create what was necessary to provide a good developmental experience. Now, what also happened was that the families that were functioning well began to have less than two children. The families that were having difficulty, most dysfunctional, had five children and more. Now, in three generations, what you had was an explosion of the dysfunctional families, children from dysfunctional families, unable to meet the expectation of the school, and there was this intergenerational transmission of the negative characteristics, and the children weren't ready. Now, on the school side and the education side, they could have and should have helped prevent what actually eventually happened. But the school and education has a traditional model, as mentioned, that is wrong. It's just flawed. The idea is a mechanical idea of input-output when children are not mechanical objects. They develop, and it is the interaction that allows them to develop and learn. And development and learning are inextricably linked, and yet teachers and administrators know very little about development. Right now, at this moment, 10% schools of education do not require a single course in child development. 90% require at least one, and that's what most people have, is at least one, just one. And 65% of those courses are taught outside of the school of education. And so they are not prepared in a way that allows them to come in and provide the children with what they need to be successful in school. And so on the one side, you have a disproportionate number of children who lived under difficult circumstances who are underdeveloped. And on the other side, you have a disproportionate number of teachers and administrators who are unprepared to compensate for that underdevelopment. And yet we know that it can be done. But these factors, both the historical, economic, political, and what's happened to families as a result, is the cause of our current problem. And yet what can be done, we know, because we've seen over the last 43 years, I've worked in schools, over 1,000 schools, where we've been able to turn around in 2/3 of those schools, in a third, dramatically, the achievement performance of the students. That is what needs to be done, and I'll come back and talk about that later.
Thank you, Dr. Comer. If you'd turn off your little green light now. And I see our final panelist has been on enough of these panels to know that she should turn on her little green light now. That is Michelle Rhee. I know you, like the other panelists, have some ideas about solutions, but from your perspective, let's just talk about the problem initially. What is your sense? We've heard that poverty is a problem. We've heard that families are a problem. We've heard that perceptions and so forth are a problem. What do you see?
So I am going to talk a little bit about the problems from my perspective, but before I do so, I just want to say that we have to be a little careful when we are doing this, because too often in the education reform debate right now, people are looking for the answer. Why are we in this position that we're in? And they want a really quick, short answer, and then they want the silver bullet solution. And there are no easy answers to the question of why are we in the state that we are today, nor are there easy answers to how we fix the situation. And so, you know, given that we have a 4-minute time limit, I'm a little cognizant of the fact that this all might get synthesized into seeming easy when it's not. My fellow panelists talked a lot about some of the cultural and societal and environmental issues, which undoubtedly play a large part in why the achievement gap exists. I'm going to talk a little bit about it from the perspective of having run a school district. I entered into the DC Public Schools, which was, at the time that I started my job, largely known as the most dysfunctional and lowest performing school district in the country. And when I got there, what I found was a system that literally was operating in diametric opposition to the way that you would want a functional district to operate and to serve kids. When I got there, I was in school buildings and heard countless stories about how the children did not have books to learn. And what I realized very quickly was it wasn't that the district didn't have books, because we actually found them in the warehouse. They just hadn't been delivered to the school buildings. We had dozens and dozens, hundreds of teachers who told us that they had been working for months without having been paid. I remember getting an email in my early few weeks in the district from a teacher who was just beside himself. He had learned that he, for about a year and a half, had been paying for health benefits, but somehow the district had messed up, and even though they were taking the contribution out of his paycheck, they had never signed him up for health benefits. And he didn't realize that until his wife had to go to the emergency room because she was sick and found out, you have no health coverage. And so as the bills were piling up and he was trying to figure things out, he literally saying, I cannot concentrate on coming to school and doing my job every day because I'm terrified that something is going to happen to my wife. We had a system where we very excitedly, in my first few months in office, decided that we were going to buy 6,000 computers and deploy them in classrooms all across the city. And we thought, this is going to be wonderful. We're going to start to close the digital divide. And within hours of our chief technology officer and his entire team being out in the schools, I got a call saying, we can't install the computers. And I said, why not? And they said, because many of these classrooms only have two-pronged outlets. They don't even have the three-pronged outlets that would support a computer being put in the room. I said, okay, this is 2007. Don't we have adapters or something like that? And they said, you don't understand. In order to support the kind of electricity that we would be needing, it would blow the entire electrical system of the entire school. We are going to require a wholesale renovation of all of these schools in order to make this possible. So you had a lot of these structural and sort of cultural issues that were going on within the school district. We also had a situation where a lot of the decisions, a lot of the policies that were being made were being dictated by politics. So in my first 100 days, I announced to the city that we had to close schools. And if you quickly want to become a really unpopular person in any city, just tell somebody that you're going to close a school, much less 23, which is what we decided we needed to close in DC. And people, were up in arms. Closing schools is a very emotional and difficult process. And I remember sitting in a meeting with a number of politicians across the city, one of whom said to me, you know what, Michelle, we know that we have to close schools. We know that we have too few kids and too many buildings, and we've been talking about this for years, and so all of us know and understand that we have to close schools, and you can close as many schools as you want to, as long as none of them are in my ward. And I thought, well, great, if every one of the 8 ward council members says the same thing, then we're not going to be able to close any schools. And what we found was that a lot of the decisions that were being made on the basis of politics. The last, I think, is the complete and utter lack of accountability that existed in the system. When I first started my work in 2007, we had a situation in our city where only 8% of the 8th graders in the city schools were on grade level in mathematics. 8%. Which means that 92% of our young people did not have the skills and knowledge necessary to be productive members of society. At the same time, I asked to see what the evaluation, the performance evaluations of the adults in the system looked like. And as it turned out, 95% of the adults were being rated as doing an excellent job. How can you have a system where all of the adults are running around thinking, I'm doing great work, but what we were producing for children was 8% success? There was, and in my opinion, you cannot have a functional organization, a healthy organization, with that kind of a disconnect between the people who were tasked with educating kids every day and the results that they were seeing. So if I had to put it into these buckets, I would sort of talk about the sort of culture, environmental, and infrastructure issues of the district, the fact that so many decisions were being made on a political basis instead of a focus on what was good and right for kids, and then last, the fact that there was very little accountability for the results that we were seeing.
Thank you, Michelle. Let me just go back to you then to start, not the second round of what we do about it, but just to get you to react to some of the other panelists' ideas about, you know, the problems. In the D.C. public school system, you surely have poverty as an equation. How much of the problem do you think there stems also from poverty? How does that factor into your equation?
If you walked into the vast majority of schools in Washington, D.C., you could not help but know that the fact that our kids, many of them, were coming from environments where they were not getting the healthcare that they needed, the nutrition that they needed every day. Many of them were coming from home environments that were not stable. Those are all definitely factors that contributed to the fact that our children reached the schoolhouse door every day at a disadvantage. There's just no way to deny that. So does poverty and home circumstance and environment play a role in children's readiness and ability, to come to school every day ready to learn? There's no doubt about that, and that's why we put in place significant interventions and programs and services to try to address those things. We put in place not only, so we had always a lunch program, we put in place both a free breakfast program in every single one of our schools, but as I was leaving, we also added dinner, supper, for all the kids who were in after school, knowing that many of our kids, the only meals that they were getting every day were from school, and so why not provide 3 square meals every day? We put nurses in every single one of the 123 schools that we had for the first time in the history of the Washington, D.C. schools. We also made sure that kids had access to art, music, PE teachers, librarians, and a social worker or guidance counselor. We also put in place in our middle schools what we call the full-service school model, which provided wraparound services for kids because we knew that the middle school was where the kids, in many ways, were most at risk because the vast majority of kids who drop out of high school make the decision to do so at the middle school level. So those issues were important. We put in place things that to address them. But what we wanted to do was make sure that we were orienting our staff and everybody who worked in the district to an aspiration, a belief that despite all of those challenges every day that the kids faced, that it was absolutely possible to overcome those challenges if we were setting up the right structures in schools. Because what I didn't want to do was create an environment where people were saying, okay, well, you know, because of this and because of that, that's why kids can't learn, or that's why our achievement levels are so low. And from my perspective, I thought, well, you know what? There is a director of mental health, there is a police chief, there are all these people out there in the city that are tasked with dealing with the sort of, you know, safety and security of kids, with the mental health of kids, with the nutritional health of kids, et cetera. My job and my purview is schools. And within the schools, we have to come to work every day knowing that despite every single one of the challenges that our kids come to us with, that it is possible to ensure that they're still achieving at high levels academically, and you are not allowed to come to work every day unless you have that belief in you.
Okay. Thank you. Let me just ask, to go back to this point that you made about lack of accountability, Angel, how much of a problem do you see that as political issues that get in the way of closing this gap? I mean, is the District of Columbia unique?
Right. Well, I mean, I think Michelle said it perfectly when she said, look, we're looking for a silver bullet. And what happens is people actually believe that we're going to solve the problem within the next 5 years. Like, I hear that to me, and it sounds, it's like telling me you're going to get to California in 10 minutes. I don't know how you're going to do that. That's how it sounds to me. And so I think that what happens is there's the pressure of trying to find a solution, and we, people feel that political pressure to try to, you know, look for that silver bullet.
But Diane, isn't the legislation that's now pending in Congress promising a silver bullet?
We have an achievement gap on this panel. I don't know how to turn the microphone on. What we have is the law of the land today is the Bush era No Child Left Behind law, which says that 100% of children will be proficient in math and in reading by the year 2014, and schools that are not on track to meet that goal will face severe consequences, like firing the principal, firing the staff, closing the school, turning the school over to private management. And Secretary Duncan said just recently that 82% of the schools will be failing schools this year. This is the most ridiculous piece of legislation ever passed by Congress. The silver bullet idea is if you just test and test, and we are now, as a nation, investing billions in testing. If we took all the billions that went into testing and put it into early childhood education, we would make a big change.
But if you don't test, how do you measure progress, and how do you assess the teachers and the staff of schools?
First of all, you need testing for information, but we're using testing now as punishments. And that's why we're seeing so many cheating scandals in Baltimore and Washington, D.C., and Pennsylvania and Atlanta, because people are being told if you don't meet an impossible goal, you're going to be humiliated, and then you're going to be fired, and your school will be closed. And when people are under the gun, some people do terrible things. So, yeah, we should use tests diagnostically. We should use them to help children. We should use them to help teachers improve their instruction. But there is just a huge body of research that says that when you tie incentives to test scores, the tests themselves become invalid because you then start teaching kids how to take the test. And then they learn test-taking skills, and when they get into a community college, they don't even know how to read, write, or do mathematics. All they know how to do is take tests about reading, writing, and mathematics.
Angel, you wanted to intervene?
Yeah, I think this is the use of testing and all the solutions that we come up with or we propose. I think it has a lot to do with the fact that there's this core model that we have for education, and for some reason, we work around this core, so we make incremental changes. Let's tweak this. Now let's do this. Now let's do this. And in doing that, we wonder why we're spinning our wheels and nothing's happening. We're not getting traction and no solution is working. We're pouring tons of money into it. And part of it is that we're working with this model that, again, I think is incompatible with how people who are disadvantaged see the world. What we need is a new model. I don't know what that looks like, right? But we need a new model. But we need a new model. So in other words, if you're not going to change the game of basketball by raising the goal by 1 inch. You're not going to change the game of football by adding 1 yard to the field, right? We need 6 goals in the game of basketball. We need 8 bases in baseball. That looks completely different, and that's what we need. We need a whole new model of education that takes into account the fact that, you know, the model we have now is not resonating with the vision that some, you know, our kids are basically squinting to see what the model suggests they should be seeing.
But Jim Comer, the administration wants to change aspects of the No Child Left Behind legislation, including changing the name. Is that promising?
No.
Why not?
I think Angel had it. We're entrenched in a mechanical model that grew out of the industrial age of how children learn and how teachers should teach. It's wrong, and it has damaged more people than anything else I can imagine.
But why is it so much more damaging to, I mean, we hear all the time, because, well, we hear the debate. There's a crisis in education.
But I just read a piece of paper in the New Yorker that says there is no crisis in education. Well, so why is it that if everything that you all are saying is true, it's the black kids who are suffering the most?
Because the black community, kids. Because the black community is most vulnerable and has been most vulnerable. But it's not only black kids, poor white kids, Southeast Asian kids, some, and Hispanic kids are all suffering because the nature of their economic, social, political experience has been such that they are growing up in vulnerable families that can't prepare them for school. And you need a model that recognizes that the kids come to school underdeveloped. And that every teacher, the most efficient and effective way to improve American education is to help every teacher and every administrator understand how to create a culture in school that supports the development of kids so that they can learn. Because it's development, when children are developing well, they can learn. And so you can't try to teach ignore at the same time ignore development.
Michelle?
I want to address this issue that Dr. Ravitch was talking about, sort of, you know, testing and it being punitive, et cetera. I think that there is a misperception around this that I'm very worried about. I think we have to look at it from the perspective of if we're going to look at testing data and use that data then to determine what we should be doing better and making sure that we're, you know, not being punitive, I would ask you this. What would you do if you saw data that came back that said that a teacher, year in and year out for the last 5 years, for the children in her class, not only didn't improve their learning and their academic progress, but the kids in her class every year for the last 5 years has gone backwards. They've lost ground. Do you keep that person in the classroom or not? See, when I was the chancellor in Washington, D.C., I put my own two kids in the D.C. public schools. That raised the stakes, because that meant that every decision that I was making every day was going to impact my two girls. So if I was going to make the decision that, you know what, this teacher, if we see that they are ineffective, we're going to give them another year or two to see if they can get better. If I was going to make that decision, then I would have to be willing to have my kid taught by that person.
And so what do you do with that teacher? I mean, how do you make that teacher get better?
So this is my point, is that if I'm looking at it from the perspective of, would I allow my children to go into that person's classroom? The answer would be absolutely not. And nobody in this room would let their child or their grandchild go into that person's classroom either. So I don't see it as a thing where, you know, this is punitive, et cetera, because if we are not putting in place accountability, then there's still punishments. The children are the ones that are being punished for the lack of our moving in the right direction and using that data to make the decisions that we think are going to benefit them in the long run.
Diane?
Well, first of all, if you have experienced principals who are themselves master teachers, they would never let that teacher stay in the classroom. And in fact, the teaching profession is different from any other profession that I'm aware of, and that is that 50% of the people who start teaching are gone within 5 years. A lot of them have been fired. And to say that, you know, Michelle didn't say this, but people will say teachers get tenure, they never get fired. Teachers get fired all the time, and they can get fired for all kinds of reasons. But the principal has to visit that classroom, make a judgment, look at the test scores. What I find obnoxious is when a newspaper like the Los Angeles Times makes up its own scheme and prints a list of teachers in the newspaper and online and say, we're naming the names, here are the test scores. And yet there are testing experts across the country who will say, that's wrong. In what profession Do you put personnel evaluations on the web for everyone to see? It's ridiculous.
Actually, teachers don't get fired all the time. Less than 1% of the teachers in this country get fired. In fact, it is incredibly difficult to fire a teacher. There is data that shows this definitively. In some case, I mean, in New York City, they showed that on average, it takes 3 to 4 years and $250,000 to remove an ineffective teacher from the classroom.
It is very easy to get caught up in the hiring and firing and the accountability and so on, and ignore the preparation of teachers. You know, it's not fair to the teacher who wasn't prepared to teach to then blame him or her for not being able to teach. Most of our money and most of our energy and most of our time goes into the issue of accountability. But you know, I'm a physician, and I know that the thermometer does not tell you much other than that there's something wrong. That's all a test score tells you. It is the whole process of preparing teachers and managing and organizing schools and the model that we're operating from that is wrong. And if we get caught up and get to fighting over this and this piece and that piece and the other of education and miss that critical dynamic, the preparation of teachers, the preparation of kids, then we'll never change it. We'll be another 50 years and we'll still won't have it.
But you have an enormous number of teachers who are already in the system and are not being and as you say, and as everyone here has said, many of whom are not prepared. So maybe you can change the paradigm but what do you do with all of those who are in the classroom today?
There's something called selection, induction, and continuing support that needs to be present in all schools, but it also needs to be focused around a new model, and that is on providing that. We went into Detroit, which is the toughest union town in the country, and got the union head involved in thinking about these issues. We went into a room where people were hopeless. 3 years later, they were excited, they were sky high because they carried out a process where they learned about kids. They learned about involving parents on the job, and that could be done. And that's what I think needs to be done, has to be done.
See, I think this is the problem we get into, is that someone has to take the hit. Someone has to be the fall guy, right? So it's teachers, it's families, it's parents, but someone's got to take the blame for this. Someone's going down. As opposed to saying, well, you know, we're gonna continue trying to point a finger at something because we're nibbling around the edges. One of the things I don't like about the blame game is that it can lead to narratives of cultural deficiency, right? So, for example, when people say it's parents, it's families, what they're really saying is that it's black parents and it's black families. And so what I don't like about that narrative is, one, I just don't like it just for just ideological reasons, but two, it's not rooted in empiricism. We have to remember, so before I follow through, we have to remember, let's not make the outlier the norm. Okay, so there are some black people who grew up in South Central LA and they made it out. That's not the norm, that's the exception, right? And so that person can say, oh, I made it, everyone can make it. Wait a minute, there's a distribution here, let's not forget that. So now, when people say about parents and parental involvement, parenting is important, okay? Parenting is important. What I'm gonna say is that parental involvement, empirically, I find is not linked to achievement. Let me backtrack. We like to think that we're important, right? We like to, so from an emotional standpoint, we want to believe that, right? But I'm an empiricist, and so I go based on what the data tell me. What I find is that What we do is we do something called statistically controlled. So for example, if in this room there was a gender gap and say males perform better than females on some task, and we said, well, it's because most of the males are sitting toward the front. Let's control for seating arrangement. Now, if we randomize and retest, and the gap goes from 20 points to 10, then we've accounted for 50% of it. We've controlled for seating arrangement. That is, we've compared males and females who are similarly situated from the front with regard to seating. That's control. Okay, when you control for parental involvement characteristics, and I control for 61 of them, in other words, talking to the teacher, talking to the principal, reading to the child, choosing the child's classes, helping the child read, helping the child with homework, 61 of these, I found that that reduced the black-white gap by 7%. Okay, now, see, people will see the connection between an affluent parent or black kid is doing well, and they'll say, oh, look, this parent is really involved, therefore it's because the child is doing well because of the parental involvement. And here's how I explain that. If you walk through someone's home in South Central LA in the worst neighborhood you can find, and you just walk through the home for 10 seconds, then you come out. Now we walk through Charlene's house for 10 seconds, or Henry Louis Gates' house for 10 seconds, and then you come out. They don't even have to say a word to their children. You're gonna realize which child is gonna learn more.
Yeah.
It's not anything they're doing. They don't even have to parent. It's just the space that they've created. It's in the air, they're breathing different air. It's the home office. It's when you get in the car, you turn the car on, NPR happens to be playing. It's the verbal jousting. Your colleague says something, and then you say, well, wait a minute, I don't know if that's the case. Your child is in the other room listening to that verbal jousting and picking up those skills, and so they're essentially living the lives that they would live whether they had children or not. But you know what? They're going to get credit for saying, oh, you guys are so involved. Your kids are doing well academically. It's because they have, and then there are some parents who don't have. You see what I'm saying? And it's really a resource thing. That's why Dr. Comer mentioned the people who are doing poorly academically are blacks, Latinos, Southeast Asians. Who are these people? People who don't have resources. When I controlled for parents' education and income, I found that that accounted for 25% of the gap. Those two factors accounted for more of the gap than 61 measures of parental involvement.
Okay, so we have a situation in this country now where so many people are out of work. We have a depressed economy. We don't see any end to this. So we've drilled down to a certain extent into the problem, as you academics say, you drill down into things, right? What do you do about it? There are no jobs out there. And so the parents don't have jobs. So they can't have, you made certain presumptions about my house, which may or may not be the case, but let's say for the sake of this discussion, you were right. Okay. What do you do?
Well, that's the thing, is that I respect the problem too much to say that I have a solution in my brain. It's complicated, and we need people who know a lot more about education and teaching and kids. I'm not in the classroom. I don't know about kids that way. We need people who really, really understand this to come up with a solution. Having said that, you know, I think that the solution, and I think I've alluded to this earlier, is we need a whole new model. I don't know what that looks like, right? But we need a whole new model. Clearly, the one that we have now is not doing it, and that's the problem. Is that we can do like the Harlem Children's Zone, and we can just give people a bunch of resources. Is that sustainable economically, on a wide scale? I don't know.
Well, let me ask Diane, because if poverty is the problem, how do you fix that?
Okay, the truth is that our society is going in the wrong direction. And we should do what works. And I'll tell you what works based on research. First of all, we should be making sure that every woman who becomes pregnant in this nation has adequate medical and nutritional care. Women who have children who don't have that are likely to have low birth weight babies, and one-third of those children will probably have learning disabilities, and they were at greater risk for autism. That's just a fact. So we could stop a big chunk of the achievement gap just by making sure that babies are born healthy. That's a good start. And when I think of all the billions spent on testing, we could have solved that problem by now just in the last 10 years. We should have, again, research-based early childhood education. We know that it works, and we're not investing enough in early childhood education. I know that the president plans to. And by early childhood education, I'm not talking about just cognitive skills, but the kind of non-cognitive skills that are also necessary that Dr. Comer emphasizes. We have a Nobel Prize winning recipient, James Heckman, who has demonstrated early childhood education works. It's important for child development. We also know from Project Star in Tennessee, class size reduction works, especially for black children. It's, for some reason, black children are more responsive to small class sizes, and yet they are, in most of our inner cities, in increasingly large classes as budgets are being cut. We know that desegregation had a huge impact on the black white achievement gap in the 70s and 80s. It was one of the factors that was identified in the various studies of the reduction and why that worked, desegregation. And one of the most successful places in this country, Wake County, North Carolina, where they had a desegregation plan that the community was very proud of, and some very wealthy out-of-state people came in and ran school board candidates saying, we don't want busing, and they just elected a school board that is going to take away their very successful program that has reduced the achievement gap very substantially. And there was a book written about it called Why Are There No Bad Schools in Wake County? That book's going to have to be rewritten. There'll have to be another chapter about why did the bad schools come back. Basic nutrition, basic health care, many children lack that. Every school, what's happened in the era of No Child Left Behind testing is that many schools have dropped the arts. Many schools have dropped physical education. Many schools have dropped the things that bring children to school joyfully. You cannot have good education without having things that kids actually want to do in school. No one wants to come to school to be tested. And I'm not, and again, I'm not saying we shouldn't have tests. I'm just saying we should have a lot fewer tests. And it's also very important that our schools have the resources they need. Some of our suburban schools have twice as much resources as the inner city schools, and that's not right.
But isn't that a matter of politics?
It is a matter of politics. We have, in the last election, we elected 18 governors who are cutting the education budget, who are increasing class size, who are privatizing schools, and who are actually imposing vouchers, which have a terrible track record. The children in Milwaukee have had vouchers now for 21 years, and their test scores are about the same as the kids in as black kids in Louisiana, Mississippi, and Georgia after 21 years. So we have a lot of states that are heading in the wrong direction, and it's a matter of politics. It's not going to change until people demand a change.
You've had a very successful model for so many years. Why isn't it catching on in more places and having more successes and not having a reason to have this panel?
Truth is, I don't know the answer to that question. On the other hand, I think it is primarily because, I mean, I don't disagree with anything that's been said here. But I do think most people don't understand. Most people take credit for their own achievement as has something to do with their brain and their willingness to work and their and so on. And so we underemphasize this whole business of the quality of the interaction between the child and the not only the authority figures, but as mentioned, the environment that they're in. And that we have to systematically create such environments and create people in those environments that can interact with children in a way that promote the development across the board. Now, I don't believe that the school alone can do this job. I believe that the communities that have been most adversely affected are going to have to mobilize in a way that they send a message to kids that's very different from the one that they're hearing right now. It's going back to what Skip Gates talked about, what we believed was so important in right out of slavery and in the 40s and the 50s and so on. That message has to be sent from a community that is respected by young people. And we're not organized to do that. We're not even organizing to do that. And I believe that in addition to the schools changing and focusing on support for development, the community itself has to focus on support for development. And I think with that combination, we can give children the kind of environment they need to develop well and learn well.
And you've been successful at it. In how many schools?
We've been in over 1,000 schools in the 40 years. I'd say that two-thirds have made progress, a third have made dramatic progress. Right now, we can equal, many of the schools equal the state in achievement levels. And they have social, psychological, emotional development that gives them a chance to be successful in life, because we don't focus on the test scores alone. It's preparation for life that we focus on. And in the process, the children do well in school.
Michelle, I know you say there's no silver bullet, but where do you start getting this, what Skip Gates referred to a while ago as a civil rights movement for education? Or have we passed the point where we do that anymore?
So I may contradict myself a little bit here, which is I did say that there is no silver bullet, and I think it's important to acknowledge that. But at the same time, I also think that we have to have a real sense of urgency around trying to fix the system. I don't think that it's okay to say, you know what, it's gonna take 30 or 40 years, so everybody just be patient and sit still, because the children who are in our schools today who are not learning how to read are going to be at a significant disadvantage unless we have a much, much greater sense of urgency around what we're doing. I'm gonna read a quote. This is actually one of my favorite quotes. It says, "There is a tendency to rationalize poor performance by implying that poverty equals destiny, and so no one is to blame for failure. The challenge to public education today is not to reinforce the correlation between achievement and social class, but to sever it." That's actually a quote from Dr. Ravitch, that in an op-ed that she wrote in the Washington Post. The reason why I love this quote so much is because it's not sort of saying, okay, it to me is incredibly aspirational. So we understand that environmental factors, cultural factors, et cetera, play a role in where we are today and put kids at a disadvantage. But shouldn't we aspire to do everything that we possibly can within the schools to put kids in a wildly different place? And that's why I think this thing about sort of the blame game is weird to me, because if we're saying, for a teacher, for example, who is not showing that they can move student achievement levels forward, and if we make the decision based on that data to remove that teacher from the classroom, to me that's not a blame game. To me, it's saying that we know from the data that if a child, a poor child of color, who's growing up in the inner city, has four teachers in a row who are in the top quartile of performance, that it can literally close the achievement gap, then why shouldn't we be doing everything that we possibly can to make sure that every single child can have one of those teachers? Now, that's not, I'm saying in trying to do that, that's not necessarily blaming anybody for the problems. It's just changing the mindset to be aspirational. Why shouldn't we be doing everything that we possibly can do within the confines of the school, knowing that there's lots of other things that we can be doing and we should be doing, but within the confines of the school, what do we control and what do we know? What we know is that within in-school factors, the one thing that has the most impact on student achievement levels is the quality of teacher in front of the child every day.
Diane, thank you. Diane and then Angel.
Yes. There's been several economists who have said three great teachers in a row, four great teachers in a row, five great teachers in a row. The problem is that the way they rank teachers changes all the time, so that one year somebody who's in the top quartile, the next year might be in the second quartile, and it's very hard to know in advance who those great teachers are. So you probably need 5 years of data, at which point you'll have a very small number of teachers, and no one has figured out how to staff an entire school or an entire district with absolutely top quartile teachers. It's a wonderful aspiration. Unfortunately, it has never happened. It's a rough calculation by economists. We must, and I appreciate Michelle for quoting something I wrote many years ago, which I still believe in. I think we must aspire for excellence for every child. We must insist on equity, and that should be our goal. But we also must stop this trashing of teachers. I have been on a lecture tour. I have been speaking this last year, and I've talked to many, many teachers. The profound demoralization among teachers in America today is almost hard to convey. Teachers feel that they are now being held solely accountable for everything, for social conditions beyond their control. And of course they should be held accountable for teaching kids to read, and of course principals should be very tough on them, but we should have principals who are master teachers who can help them, who can make sure they have the developmental knowledge that Dr. Comer talks about. And we have to have an ethos in education of encouragement, support, promotion of what we know to be right for children, and at the same time, encourage and respect teachers and stop beating up on them.
Angel?
So I wanted to clarify something. When I said that the gap is the projection suggests that it's gonna take 6 decades in reading to close and 10 decades in math, I certainly think that we have to have a sense of urgency, right? But urgency is different from impulse. We can't be impulsive, right? We have to be pretty intelligent about this. And it doesn't mean a teacher's not effective, let's get rid of her. Perhaps we can retrain. The teaching profession is something that has to be elevated to a higher status to make more people want to do it. I mean, if we're frank with ourselves, we know that in general, schools of ed do not get the best students because it's not a high-paying job. The best students are going to go to sociology and get the best students. They're going to go to physics. They're going to go to engineering. They're going to go to biology, chemistry. So that's, we have to elevate the prestige of the teaching profession. We have to have a sense of urgency. Look, by 2040, 50% of the population are going to be black and brown. You can't have half of your population walking around with eighth grade skill sets, and that doesn't affect everyone. It's going to affect everyone. So we have to have urgency, but we can't be impulsive, because impulse leads us to spend millions of dollars spinning our wheels, trying to come up with this policy, this policy, this policy, and at the end of the day, you're just tweaking the same model. And we have to have a model that says, you know what, doesn't matter whether your parent can read or whether your parent's a professor at Yale or Harvard. That shouldn't matter. The model accounts for a different lens of the world. So it doesn't really matter what your background is.
But I want to ask you a quick question before, I know Jim is eager to get into this, but my brother-in-law once was going on and on about they do this and they that, and I said, well, who are you talking about, they? And he said, well, if you have to ask me that, it means they've already gotten to you. I say that because you continue to say we. Who are we talking about here? Who is we?
I'm projecting my sense of urgency and my respect for the depth of the problem to everyone else. And so I say we because I think we have to be altruistic. At the end of the day, we feel like, look, we have to ask ourselves, there's a gap. Some people actually benefit from this gap, right? I want my kid to go to Harvard and Yale. So if I can eliminate some people from the pool of contention, then that's a good thing, right? We have to be altruistic because I have a 3-year-old, and I understand that, look, the gap is going to be here for as long as she's in school. And you know what? I understand that, and I'm willing to say it's fine if we can get a real solution that can close it in 20 years, in 30 years. Because when she's an adult, I don't want half the population walking around with 8th grade skill sets. What I don't want is someone, I don't want to feel like we have to solve this in the next 2 years. That's, I mean, you're gonna walk in guns blazing, pow, 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 and that's not gonna, it's not gonna solve anything. It hasn't.
Thanks, Jim.
I was gonna make one point, but you've motivated me to make two. Okay. When you say, who is we? There is a very specific group of people who make decisions about education in this country, and they're mostly at the state level. And that group of people will need to know much more about how children learn, and they will have to be pressure has to be put on so that they will act in a way that is responsive to what we know about how children learn. You've got the policymakers in the legislature, you've got the policymakers at the state departments of education, you've got the policymakers and decision makers in schools of education, and that group of people make the decisions that they are the we. And that's the group we've got to put some pressure on to pay attention to create the need to create the model that he keeps talking about, the model change. That's one response. The second is... The second is we've talked about teachers, but you know, teachers don't work alone. They shouldn't work alone. They are in buildings that should be cultures, and they should be learning together in those buildings and learn from each other and learn from parents and learn from kids themselves. And that is what we are missing, and that's the model that needs to be created.
Michelle?
I absolutely agree with that. I also agree wholeheartedly with what Dr. Ravitch was saying as well. I mean, she said, yes, we should have accountability, and yes, people should be held accountable for whether kids are learning how to read, but we have to create the right kind of environment. That's 100%. I mean, people in D.C. used to say to me every day when I was walking up and down the streets, oh my gosh, you have the hardest job in the city. And I would always say, no, I don't. The hardest job in this city is being an effective teacher in one of our schools. There is no harder job every day than going into a classroom and knowing that 24 or 26 or 30 kids are counting on you. And we have to figure out a way that we can recognize and reward our most highly effective teachers. I mean, it is the fact remains that they are such an important part every day of the learning experience that our children have, and they have to be in an environment where they feel respected and where we are doing everything that we can to create a culture where they feel valued.
Thank you.
So what I was going to say is something occurred to me. So I was thinking, you know, we need to have more fruitful discussions about the achievement gap and how to solve it. And so one of the things I do in my work as a quantitative researcher is I'll pose questions and look at the answer, and I'll give the answer, and the answer won't rely on my gut, my opinion. It's just what the numbers tell me. 2 + 2 = 4. So here's one thing that might be fruitful from this. So the parental involvement thing that I was telling you about. So this is a book that's due to Harvard Press next month, and it might not make it. But one of the findings in this book was I looked at, using national data, I looked at how parents respond to poor performance. Now, there was a question that asked parents, how do you respond to poor performance if your child performs lower than expected? Okay. And there were a series of measures of parental involvement. Talk to the child, talk to the teacher, punish the child. I lumped them into two categories, punitive and non-punitive. Then I said, okay. This is based on national data. I compared black and white parents in terms of, you know, which one they engage in more. We all know the findings. Black parents are more likely to engage in punitive responses to poor performance, and white parents to non-punitive. When I linked that to achievement, I found that punitive responses lead to declines in achievement for black and white kids. Non-punitive lead to increases in achievement. So what's essentially, if you put those two findings together, you say, wow, blacks are doing more of what hurts and less of what helps. So when I hear people say, get the parents involved, bring them in, I say, wait a minute. We have to be careful, you know, you have to be careful what you ask for. We assume that parental involvement is good, and I say, wait. We have to first know what the information is. It may be good in theory, it makes us feel good, it's a feel good parental involvement is involved. But empirically, they have to know how to be involved. And you have to make sure that, you know, maybe have a session on how to respond to poor performance. Punitive parenting is not the way. We should be having these kinds of discussions, asking and answering questions around things like this that perhaps you say, well, you know, we have to make more informed decisions as opposed to just making decisions.
Do you know what the data looks like for Asian parents? I'm just curious.
Yeah, no, yeah. What I found is
they're pretty punitive too.
I compared black, white, Mexican Americans, non-Mexican, and Asian Americans. And Asian Americans, I break them into two categories. Sort of your model minority Asians, your Chinese, Korean, and then your Southeast Asians, your more disadvantaged Asians. And what I find is that there are no differences, very little differences on these measures of parental involvement when their parental involvement at home, reading to the child, talking to the child. I find no very little differences across race. Now, if a black and white parent both say they read to the child, it could be very different. I'm reading to you like this, versus reading to you like this, right? It's two different ways of reading to the child, right? So it's not the same thing. But nevertheless, there's no difference in reporting in terms of parental involvement differences. When I look at the link between parental involvement and achievement, I do find big differences. Most of the forms of parental involvement, many of them lead to increases for whites, not for Latinos, not for blacks, and not for Asian Americans. When I present this, Asian Americans usually say, they come up to me at the end and say, that doesn't surprise us because that's not what we count as parental involvement. So there you have it.
Diane and then Jim, and then we're going to have Professor Bobo sum up briefly so that we can engage the audience, because I would imagine that many of you have questions, and we have mics on either side of this over there and here. So start to think about your questions, or if you just want to make an intervention. Those of you who've been to this panel session before know that I ask you to be pithy and brief. Jim? Oh, no, Diane. It was Diane.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Okay. We've been talking, a thread in the conversation this evening is about having a new way of looking at how we educate children. And what I've discovered looking over the 20th century and now in this part of our new century is that we are wedded, and I'm speaking now of the power centers that Dr. Comer didn't mention, meaning Congress and the U.S. Department of Education, and the governors, are wedded to this idea that the way to improve education is by threatening people, by punishing people, by offering them rewards if they get higher test scores. This is called test-based accountability, and there was just a major, major report. And right before Memorial Day came from the National Research Council, the most prestigious research group in the country, that said test-based accountability doesn't work. It leads to narrowing of the curriculum so that schools drop the arts and history and civics and foreign languages. It leads to cheating. It leads to gaming the system. That what people need in their lives is instead of a threatening them and promising them merit pay, which has never worked. Merit pay has been tried since the 1920s. It has never, ever had a positive impact, and it has been evaluated time and again. It makes no difference whatever, whether people are offered a bonus or not. Threatening them doesn't make them better either. It just leads them to do bad things like cheat. What people need in order to be professional, and what I think children need in order to be strong in school, is first of all, appeal to a sense of purpose, especially among professionals, autonomy. I would urge you all to read the work of Dan Ariely of MIT in North Carolina, Daniel Pink, his wonderful book Drive, about what motivates people. People are motivated mainly by a sense of purpose, particularly if they become teachers. They don't become teachers because they expect to make a lot of money. They become teachers because they want to make a difference in the lives of children. And with children, instead of using punishments and rewards, we should look to the principles that Dr. Comer talks about. Each child is a precious human being. And forgive me for saying this, but I'm borrowing from my Catholic friend. Each child is a precious human being in the sight of God. No one gets thrown away. Everyone gets help.
Professor Bobo, could we have a brief, pithy but brief, were you next? Okay, you were looking at me like you wanted to say something.
No, I just want to agree, but also Angel keeps making the point about the importance of the quantitative evidence, and I agree with that. But I also want to talk about the qualitative and remind us that observations in class, in schools, with parents, with everybody trying to examine the issue is an important way, and an important way we need to practice education in the same way that we practice medicine. You know, and and we need to do it. You know, in 1910, when medicine reformed itself, it looked at what are the disciplines and what's the knowledge base that we need? And the knowledge base was anatomy and physiology. There's a knowledge base in education that we need also. It has to do with the academics, and it also has to do with the promotion of child development. And focusing that on the preparation of children for the future, and then learning how to do that in every gathering inside and outside of the school that we have about education.
We're going to have some more interaction with the panel based on what our audience questions are, but let's just do a brief summary of where we are right now, Professor Bobo.
Well, thank you, and really, I want to thank the panel for what's been a remarkably rich and thoroughgoing session, having hit on at least most of what I understand to be the key issues out there, and I hope the rest of you feel that way as well. But let me begin by way of summary and remind us all of just the gravity of the problem that's out there, that we still live in a time and a country and a place where 35% of young African Americans are going to spend part of their childhood below the poverty line, where we know there is a gap in attainment, how much schooling people complete, and in achievement, what seems to be the cognitive skills and levels of mastery that they take from or derive from schooling. Each of our panelists was asked to talk a bit about what they see as the nature of the problem or a key feature of it, and also what directions we might now be moving in to solve this problem. And let me try to draw a nugget or two out of each of those. Angel really emphasized from us at the very beginning the depth of the problem and the respect we ought to all have for the depth of a problem, which he characterized initially as essentially a 4-year gap in achievement or acquired skill sets or abilities by the end of schooling, which to my mind is probably an underestimate, and he may correct me for being closer to the data, that I suspect those are largely people who make it to high school and are through high school and are in a position to move to college. If we had a broader sample across the spectrum, it's bigger, and that the trends actually not only don't look like there's slow progress for that lower group who's already fallen off, they're almost certainly, to my mind, losing ground, so that in the larger aggregate, despite great progress in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, things are slowly getting worse or at the best have rather stagnated in the post-80 era. Diane brought a multiple message, but especially at the beginning drove home the idea that this is an old, long-standing problem, and in a country that had slavery, Jim Crow, the ghetto, and now the mass incarceration society, it should not be a surprise to any of us that there is an enduring gap in achievement. But that throughout all of that, we have to remember this reflected choices. Choices made by social policy. At a point when we could have continued the achievements that were well underway in 1968, in 1975, and even as recently as 1980, we chose a different path. We decided on a punitive path. We decided on disinvestment in schools and jobs and infrastructure in our cities. Jim tells us a twofold story, one about the profound importance of the growing body of knowledge in developmental studies and what it takes to learn well and how we can routinize that knowledge base and bring it into the classroom. But then he harked back to one of the points that both Diane and Angel had made about the depth of the problem, that we've literally seen a polarization in family structures, that the affluent, in a way, are pulling ahead. College-educated women tend to marry later in life now. They marry better-educated men. They have fewer kids. That's a kid that's getting remarkably well-prepared for schooling and advanced education down the road. Those at the bottom, falling further behind, because if they have 2, 3, 4, as the anecdote given, 5 kids, now you have, let's say, a 15, 18, 20-year-old mother with multiple kids, no husband, no economic resources. That's someone who's going to be steadily losing ground, and their kids are set behind, kind of irrespective of what any teacher brings to a classroom. And it's almost certainly the case that no teacher's been given the level, or rare, the teachers are given the level of special training it takes to cope with the array of problems that sort of person brings to a classroom, which is part of why the accountability logic is a troubling one. It says, teacher, your classroom, overcome poverty. It ain't gonna happen. It ain't gonna happen. In terms of Michelle's message, we're told that we have politics and institutionalized disorganization in many school districts that greatly inhibit the capacity of teachers or any organization to perform well at its core functions. And that in that kind of context, there's no question that accountability has to be part of the story. And it's certainly true. I guess I want to emphasize two things at the end here. And the top line story is respect for the depth of the problem. And for each and every one of us, the we in this room, to carry that message to our elected officials. And let me underscore something that I somehow end up saying every time in these sessions at this panel. Black poverty is not white poverty. There are virtually no white people in the average black poverty condition in the United States of America. Virtually none. Do you understand what that means? When a black kid is in poverty, they're more likely to be at that 50% below poverty or less level. They're more likely to be in a neighborhood where virtually all their neighbors are below poverty, where virtually none of the men in the neighborhood have jobs, where the schools have unambiguously, at least from the standpoint of testing and measurement, failed. To then expect a teacher, even a whole building of teachers, to overcome that level of structural disadvantage, or what we call cumulative disadvantage often in sociology, is just an extraordinarily misplaced analysis, to my mind. Okay? My second point is that I worry, and I guess I will make it my final point because we have had a long and rich discussion and many of you want to get involved. I think that there's a profound disconnect between policy discourse and direction at the moment and our best understanding of what works to improve education, even for the very poor and disadvantaged. And that if we need urgency, that's where the urgency ought to focus. On redirecting what's the front edge of the policy direction for the future. We have a social policy tied, to borrow a phrase I heard recently, to a 10-foot mindset when our children need to have schools and educational environments designed to free them to pursue their astronomical dreams most effectively. Thank you.
Professor Bobo, I would now like to ask those of you who have any brief questions to come up to the mics on either side, but I would like to have John Payton from the Legal Defense and Education Fund lead those questions right behind you in the middle aisle, John. And I call on John because for two reasons. One, because the Legal Defense and Education Fund was, in fact, the organization that brought us the Brown decision. And now, as I understand it, the Legal Defense Fund, the Children's Defense Fund, and other organizations like the United Negro College Fund are opposing the No Child Left Behind Act because they say that it would dismantle civil rights protections for poor students. So I thought I would ask him to give us a brief intervention as we also begin to entertain other questions.
Well, is this on? Can you hear me?
It's on.
Let me just say something first, which is that I thought the discussion that we heard was very rich and really worthwhile. And I thought that what Larry said at the end is right. There was a sense of the depth of the problem, which I think is really, really important. If we don't appreciate the depth of this problem, we won't come up with solutions that will solve it. But I also thought that what Michelle said and what she embodies, which is a sense of urgency about the need to solve this problem that has great consequences, is really a very key point. The No Child Left Behind is today's title for ESEA, the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, which is one of the core pieces of the War on Poverty, 1965 Act. And its original purpose is to make sure that we provide the assistance to those students who need assistance in their schools, but they're not getting it. That's the original point. The second point was to make sure that we have some equity across school districts. and within school districts across schools. The perversion of that, that we have heard, I think all of us, that's in No Child Left Behind, is about, I'd say, testing to an extreme measure. I think everybody agrees we have to be able to measure what we're doing. I don't think there's any disagreement about that. And I think everyone up there agreed that we don't want to turn the test into something that perverts the education. I think everybody agrees with that. And I think what we're now dealing with is the reauthorization of No Child Left Behind, the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, in a way that brings it back to its original purpose. That, unfortunately, is caught in the poison politics that we see out there today. So I think we just have to set that aside. What we have to be able to do is to appreciate the depth of this problem. It has consequences, as Jim said, that are new in our history. If you're not educated today, you don't have a place in our society today. Because we've got to figure out how we appreciate the depth of this problem, and then talk. I think everyone here thinks that among the people up there, despite their disclaimer, there are avenues to solutions that in fact, if embraced with the urgency that Michelle embodies, would lead us down a path that would really be important. And I think that's the most important thing I heard today.
Thank you. Thank you. We don't have anybody at the other mic, so this young man here, don't call me ma'am.
Young man, I like that. Hello, my name is Michael Obellamy. I'm the head of the Paul Cuffey Charter School in Providence, Rhode Island, the highest performing urban school in the state of Rhode Island. I'm very grateful to be here, and I appreciate this conversation. It's been terrific. I recognize that this is a crisis, the work that I'm doing, and there's a real urgency. But are we asking schools to do too much, to compensate for too much? As you talked about, Ms. Rhee, feeding three meals to children, having all kinds of health care for children, making up for the accumulative disadvantages, et cetera, all the things that we discussed about. Can you describe or name any other organization that is asked to do or to achieve as much as we are with as little? Should not we have the same tools or the same resources as our military to face this problem? Thank you.
Michelle?
You know, I think the resource question is a really important one, and a number of the panelists talked about that. In my estimation of things, I do actually think that more resources will be necessary in the long run. I do want to say, though, that we as educators have not created a great case for ourselves. We have more than doubled the amount of money that we are spending per child on public education in this country over the last two decades, and the results have not gotten better. Now, if we had doubled the expenditures and the results had doubled as well, then it would be a very easy case for us to go to politicians and say, if you cut our budget by this much, this is what is going to suffer. But we haven't done that. And you have school districts like Washington, D.C. and Newark, where they are spending $22,000 a year per child, and the results are absolutely in the bottom of this nation. So to me, I think the first order of operation is less about more money, because I think more money into a broken system is not going to deliver different results. I think we have to change the fundamentals of how the system is working. I think we had lots of conversations today about how to try to do that. But we need a fundamentally different system first before we can make a case, I think, to the taxpayers and other people about putting more money into it.
Well, I certainly agree that we need to improve the system in very fundamental ways, but I think it's going to cost more money. A lot of the new spending over the past 30 years, about almost 40% of it, has gone for special education. And Congress, when it passed the special education legislation, promised to pay 40% of it and has never met that 40%. So if Congress simply did what it promised to do, that would lift the fiscal burden across the country in every district in this country. But I do think that if we're going to do what has to be done in terms of early childhood education, prenatal care, a rich curriculum for every child, reducing class size, particularly in the districts where the poorest kids are and where the achievement gap is the largest, it will cost money. We are now reducing corporate taxes, reducing taxes on the richest people in this country, and cutting the budget of public education. This is crazy.
Thank you. Next question. And if you make the applause hearty but briefer, we can get more questions in.
I have a very short question then.
My
name is Sharon Thompson, and I'm a teacher, and I wanted to ask about, there are some schools, charter schools like KIPP, that have consistently been able to raise the achievement scores of their students and also hire excellent teachers. And why is it that we cannot figure out ways to scale schools like that in a greater way?
Jim Comer wants to answer that question.
There are public schools with no extra money, no selection, that have consistently improved the performance of students. And so the question is, why haven't we looked at very systematically what goes on in those places where they've been able to do that? In part it's because, and you asked me before, there's no mechanism in our system to look at and systematically analyze, understand, study what goes on in successful schools. There is no mechanism. It's all fragmented. Everybody's doing research all over the place, and there's no mechanism, nobody responsible for really looking at what's going to make a difference. That's part of the problem.
What about the Department of Education?
Well, I would like to see the Department of Education take on that role, but that is not what they've been doing so far.
Does anybody want to disagree with that? Anybody in here from the administration? All right, we'll just leave it right there, and when we see the president at Nancy's, we'll ask him about it. Next.
My name is Jane Edmonds, and I have the privilege of being a friend of Charlene Hunter Gault, so isn't that cool? But what I'd love to do is to take this panel home with me, because you are amazing in terms of your spunk and your brilliance and your intellect and your thoughtfulness and your passion. As I was sitting here, and I have to confess, I'm not a linear thinker, and I'll try to be pithy, Charlene.
Brief is the real directive.
Brief is the word. It's never been my strong suit, I must admit. My mind was drifting to another evening recently in the island. Many of us might have been in that audience when we heard Governor Wilder make the absolute essential connection between education and economic empowerment. As I listened to the panelists, and by the way, Diane, you should run for office because you're just so spunky. I mean, you're amazing. But I really wondered if any of you could comment on our president's goal, 2020 goal, which is, of course, as you know, to graduate more individuals from our colleges than in any other place in the world. And in light of your comments, would any of you comment on what your thinking is in connection with that, and what we, as we walk out of here, should be thinking about in terms of action to support that goal?
Thank you. Angel?
Well, I think, it's a nice goal to have, but we got to make sure that when they graduate college, they can read and write and do math. And so I think that it's better than saying we expect that to be the case by 2014 or 2015. But, you know, I really think that the problem really, we should focus our attention early in the schooling sort of life cycle, right? So we talk in first, second, third grade, even before that. I think that's where, to the extent that we have any extra resources to invest in education, I think that that's where the investment should be made, because that's where you're going to get the most bang for the buck.
Unless you have a different point of view, can I go to the next question? Thank you. Yes.
Thank you. My name is Joan Lonergan. I'm an educator and school leader. I want to follow up on a question in regard to schools and programs that do work, like KIPP. And my question to you is, what is the role of academia, particularly schools of education, in terms of determining what the whys and hows of that success is? and what their role is in advocating and working with school districts to make it happen rather than to be mired in research. Thank you.
Professor Bobo, can I get you to respond to that?
Well, a little bit. I think there is a growing consensus around several points about certain early childhood education supports and intervention strategies that have been found to work. The challenge here in part is scaling up, finding the material support, that is the financial support, the dollars to make these things happen. And related to the previous question, I think the kind of Obama aspiration is the right aspiration, but we haven't restructured or broken away from the accountability discourse, right? Because if that's still the primary emphasis, then we're going to be constrained in deciding that it's supporting families, it's closing a gap that's already there when the schooling starts at grade one. It's not something that's created by bad teachers in a school. It's not narrowed by them terribly much. It can be affected by them when they have the proper training and support, and it's turned into a profession that we as a society clearly respect, reward, and prepare people to carry out the burden we're placing upon them. So I guess that the final comment on the translation here is moving from kind of academic research to implementation is often a very long road. And of course, the prestige has always been on the basic research, deriving broad patterns of knowledge, not what makes it doable in 1,000 school districts and 10,000 classrooms across the country. But I think what has to happen is a policy priority that says that's our ambition. Moving KIPP and the time in school, the culture it established, to something that's a far more common pattern, right? And then get states and districts working on making it a practical reality.
Unless you have something different, radically different to say, can we, do
yeah,
you?
Yeah, I do.
Okay, can we make it brief?
For the last 5 years, I've chaired and co-chaired committees of experts who were supposed to look at how schools of education can change. And I want to make the point that there is an entrenchment there that is so deep that I don't know what we're going to do. Somebody has to take the responsibility for putting the pressure on them to change. Otherwise, you know, you can't just keep pouring year after year people into the system who are going to be out in 5 years. But that's what's going on. And it is, they're caught on a traditional, and they won't change.
I just want to make a comment about KIPP. I have been to KIPP schools, and I was very impressed with
tell
KIPP. KIPP is a charter chain that last I saw had about 100 schools, maybe 25,000 students nationally. The most recent study that came out said that their black male dropout rate is 40%. So they haven't solved that problem, but what I would like to see KIPP do, and I'm not saying this critically about KIPP because I was very impressed with the schools that I visited, I would like to see them take on the challenge of a district. Because as long as they just have a school here and a school there or a few schools in a district, there's a selection mechanism, it's called a lottery. Take on a district, that's the scale-up problem.
Thank you, yes.
Richard Cohen, and I've been a fan of the Du Bois Institute and come to many of these things, and it's the first time.
Pull up the mic.
I have been angry enough to get up and talk because this is so emotional to me. I've got kids that have reaped all the benefits of wealth and great educations, and I have a 14-year-old who's on the autistic spectrum, and seeing him flourish with, you know, a $58,000 tuition at a private school. But one of the things I've done is there are programs in New York City, the one I'm talking about is Pencil, where they match up people from the business community to partner with principals. And I have adopted the a school district, actually, in Brooklyn that deals with the learning disabled kids. And I have seen more low-hanging fruit of things that can be done. You know, examples like in New York City, you have an allowance for books, and the principals have the ability to change some of their budget items, but if you don't use your budget for books, it goes back to the district. These are learning disabled kids who need computers and interactive devices. There are schools where they're shoved in the basement and just through. I think that the key here is I am making a huge difference with this school because it's coming from the bottom up. I am knocking on doors and I am getting things done. You want to change the system, you're not going to change it from the top. You've got to change it from the grassroots and the up, and you've got to get people involved who do care and have the system listen to them from a ground up grassroots basis.
Thank you. I need to go to the other side of the room before I get to Lucy Hackney. Etienne Legrand.
Hello. Good afternoon, everybody. As Charlene said, I'm Etienne Legrand, and I run the W.E.B. Du Bois Society in Atlanta, small W.E.B. Du Bois Society compared to my dear friend Skip, but in any event, we are working there really hard on a piece of the puzzle that we think is really important in addition to everything that everyone addressed thus far, and it's really simply, how do we get students to want to learn? And when we think about that, a piece that I think is important to add, along with everything that everyone's talking about, which I couldn't agree more with, is the notion that where we are today, given the confluence of poverty and other issues, is that if you closed your eyes and just listen to what we say, and open them and look at what we do, it is in total contradiction to what we're saying. Skip mentioned, as he opened up, this notion that that athletics and entertainment just predominates the popular culture. And that obviously has a serious implication for what people think about as important and what drives them to therefore achieve and motivates them to want to achieve, along with obviously the money that goes along with that. So my question is really, as we think, incorporate all of those pieces in there, we think about the public policies that underlie some of this, part of the problem is, as I think Angel said, you know, we need a new model, and we need to begin to think about how we add these changes. But to your point about what's going on with the Department of Education and other sources, there's really a lack of innovation in education. There is no new money for different ideas. There's no money hardly for things that we know that works. We are looking for silver bullets. So I think that mindset around how we solve the problem has to be drastically different.
Thank you. Let me take the question from Lucy Hackney.
Well, I wanted to say something terrific about this place, that you are all here with this island. And the schools are amazing here. Public education here in Martha's Vineyard is terrific. And one of the reasons it happens is because we have really good health care, we have really good early childhood, and we have rich people from people who come in the summer, so we have enough money. So thank you very much.
Okay, let me just say very, very quickly, we have about 5 or 6 more minutes. And so, again, if I could, I'd like to just end the questions with the gentleman in the green shirt. So I would like to get the next 4 people in the next 2.5 minutes.
Okay, thank you. Very quickly, I am Roderick Woodruff, co-founder of the Urban Video Game Academy, a STEM after-school program in Baltimore and Washington, D.C., primarily working with charter schools in those areas. I'd just like to ask, I guess Dr. Harris, is there any quantitative data with respect to values, family values, and achievement? And to Dr. Comer, is there anything qualitative on your side with respect to value systems in parental units, in homes, that can affect achievement of students?
Thank you.
Yes, there is data on values, and essentially, I find that most parents value a good future for their children. There's no such thing as a parent who says, I don't want my kid to do well. The question is not the want. The question is the sort of know how to create the structure or the sort of home environment that allows for that to happen.
Dr. Comer?
I simply agree with that, but would again emphasize that it is the quality of the interaction, parent-child, non-punitive promotion of, and support for development that makes a difference.
All right.
Joel Greenberg from Philadelphia. I have a question for Michelle. That in Philadelphia, we have 50,000 kids on waiting lists for charter schools. And in terms of a silver bullet, in terms of, the, of solving an urgent problem, to me, that's a problem, a political problem, because the political mechanism and the powers that be refuse to allow parents to have choice, as we've all seen in saving the Waiting for Superman. So the problem really is not necessarily that there aren't solutions. There are solutions, but the politicians who are in a situation where they do not want to rock the boat and rock where they are taking tremendous donations from the teachers' union to keep the status quo and prohibit competition from affecting their monopoly. So if you could address that, Michelle, I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Sure. So I do think that it is a significant problem that we have a special interest group in this country, namely the teachers' unions, who have a tremendous amount of influence. I don't think that in and of itself is a problem. They should be doing that. They should be advocating on behalf of their members. I think the real problem is that there is no organized national interest group with the same kind of heft as the union that's advocating on behalf of children. And so we need balance in the equation. And I think that's incredibly important. I will also say, though, that I am a huge proponent of effective charter schools. You won't get a bigger one than me. But at the same time, the charter school movement as a whole has not done itself right in this debate either, because there are lots of really ineffective charter schools out there. And the whole premise behind charter schools was increased authority and autonomy for increased accountability. And for a charter school, if you're not effective, we're supposed to close you down. We have not been nearly as aggressive about ensuring that we are closing the poor performers down. And so that what happens is that the incredible performance of the highest, the most highly effective charter schools are masked by the low performance of the worst ones. And until the charter sector takes a much stronger stand and pivots away from quantity and more towards quality, I don't know that the problem is going to be solved in the long run.
Thank you. I'm going to do something that I really don't like doing, but because of the time involved, I'm going to take all three of those questions, hopefully brief ones, and then we'll see who answers. So if you don't mind stating your question, then the next person here states yours, and then you state yours, and then we'll try and get to the answers.
I just want to say that thank you for a wonderful panel. The direness of the problem of educating is even greater because I sense over the past 30 years that there might be forces at work who would like us to become a consumerocracy and an ignorocracy instead of the democracy, which I think was the original intention of the United States, and we all have to pick up our voices and follow the leadership in that direction.
But you didn't tell us who you are.
I'm Jerry Yukovich, a doctor on the island here.
Thank you, Jerry. I knew who you were, but I wanted everybody. All right, Matt.
My name is Diane Brinkley. I taught for 29 years in Newark, and we were able to incorporate Dr. Comer's methods in our school. And we were very successful, so successful that they shut us down. And I just wanted people to really do themselves a favor and do the research on his methods, because they do work. And I don't know if you heard him say that he started with a school, and after 3 years, the teachers were excited. And so you're talking about teacher accountability. Teachers become accountable when they're successful with students and when they see methods that really work.
Thank you.
My name is John Michael Caldero, a recently retired public educator of 35 years. I would like to follow up a little bit on the man in front of me. And what I see as a big concern is the goal of education. We have thousands of school districts, 50 states, all with their own standards. And we all have this nebulous view. Do we want good citizens? Do we want workers? Do we want kids to take tests? One of the difficulties that we face as educators is, what are we supposed to be teaching towards? And I'd like to get some comments on that.
Thank you. Now,
to ask you to address that question, but as you do, refer back to something that Angel said earlier, because I think it goes to the issue of why all of us, black, white, brown, whatever, need to be invested in this issue. We've talked about the fact that the disproportionate pain is being borne by young black and Hispanics, but what is at stake for all of us as you answer that question, Angel? And we, again, Skip is giving me the eye here, so we got to make this brief.
Well, I guess very briefly, I think what's at stake for all of us is, could you imagine a world in which half of the U.S. population had eighth grade skill set? Just imagine that scenario. I'll stop there in the interest of time.
Okay, quickly, I just want to reiterate what Larry Bobo said, which is I don't think there's ever been a bigger disconnect between public policy and what people on this panel have been saying here. They're like on totally different planes. One of the questioners over here said, what is it we need to do to get kids to love school? I would say let's have the arts in every school. Let's have stringed orchestras. Let's have choruses. I mean, this is what kids love, and when the budget gets cut, the first thing that goes is the things that kids love to do.
Diane, what's at stake?
What's at stake is the future of our nation, and I would make it even more important by saying what's at stake is the future of public education. I don't think we can continue with the privatization movement and see our country get better. What we'll see is a dual system recreated between the private and the public schools.
Thank you. Jim,
one last point. Sure. What's the purpose of education? Purpose of education, Massachusetts. It's about developing citizens to sustain our democracy into the future. Every single person is a citizen. Every single person has to be part of keeping this society vibrant. We cannot toss away any part of our population.
Dr. Comer?
On the schools that work point, I agree with that, and I've always thought of it as preparing children so that they can be successful in school and in life, so that they can work, be successful family members, and successful citizens. And with that, you can create a society that is vital and can sustain itself. And that is what the schools ought to be doing. But we don't have to focus on things like choice, as far as I'm concerned, or innovation, or new, finding something out. They're the basics. There is, every child needs to have adults around him or her that will help them grow so that they can do all of the things that we're talking about. And that has to start at home first, and in school second, and in all the experiences that the child has. That's why the arts and so on are important in school, not in and of themselves, but because they support the development of children. And that's where we have to go, I think.
Michelle, what's at stake?
So I'm gonna do two things at once. I'm gonna try to answer the question, and I'm gonna push back a little bit on Dr. Bobo. But don't worry, because lots of the people that I'm closest with, I started out in a fight with. So, one of the things that you said when you were summing up the panels was you said, you know, and so those people who are saying that, you know, teachers solve poverty, overcome poverty, are misguided. I just want to be clear, that's not what I said. And not only that, I don't know anybody who says that. What my point was is that we have children in school for 6.5 hours every day, 180 days a year. And in that time period, we have to believe that there is a tremendous amount that we can do to better their station in life. Right now, if you are a child born in poverty in this country, your likelihood of graduating from college is 10%. That is the most un-American thing I can imagine. The reason why we have public schools is so that every single child, regardless of whether you're black or white, rich or poor, so that every child can have an equal chance in life. That's part of the reason why we have schools. But to make statements like that, what I think it does is it creates a boogeyman, and it polarizes the debate to these extremes where actually nobody is standing. Nobody's saying teachers solve poverty. That's not what anyone's saying. So I feel like we have to get more into the nuances of what this discussion was about and the understanding that, yes, there are tremendous disadvantages, there are tremendous challenges, but in the confines of the school, in the confines of the school day and the school year, what is it that we should aspire to do? And how is it that we should be setting these systems up to give our children the best chance in life?
Thank you.
Well, I'll push back just a little. And I deliberately did not attribute it to you because I did hear you and I didn't say you said that. So let's be clear on the record.
No, I'm saying no, but I don't know
the
anybody
point,
who's saying that.
Okay.
My point is that that is in effect how policy is working. Not that that's what anyone's advocating, but because our emphasis has been on accountability, testing, and then firing and sanctioning, that's in effect what it is. Even if that's not how anybody describes it, that is in effect what it becomes. And that's disappointing and tragic because we are in effect asking teachers to solve poverty. That's not the official rhetoric. That's not how anyone rationalizes it. But unfortunately, that is what it devolves into.
And I'm going to have the last word. And I wish we could continue because as you've seen from this audience's reaction, this has been a great panel. Those of you who know me know that I'm the daughter and the granddaughter of preachers. And if you were here this time last year, you know I ended with quoting one of the preachers who is now late, gone from us, Dr. Gomes from Harvard. And this past two Sundays ago, I was listening to the president of Morehouse College at a wonderful sermon. Those were my two for the year, well, the one for the year. But I want to repeat what I said last year from Dr. Gomes, but first from Dr. Richardson. And that is, it's a long story, but I'll make it short because I'll be pithy and brief as well. He recommended that everybody read Frankenstein. He said, now, you may not be popular at the Inkwell if you take the book there, but there's a lesson in it. When Frankenstein created the monster, eventually it became a monster and became malicious. And Dr. Frankenstein said to the monster, why are you so malicious? And the monster answered, I am malicious because I'm miserable. We cannot afford to have a nation of children who continue to fall farther and farther behind and become more and more miserable because they don't have the things that other children in the society have. So Frankenstein. We move from Frankenstein to Dr. Gomes, who I hope is here with us in spirit. And this is what I left you with this time last year, and I'm going to leave it this year. And if I get invited back, I might do it next year. The we goes here. Do what you can with what you have where you are. Thank you. And as you go to your various destinations, we're going to bring back Joshua Bennett, who's going to send you on your way. You can start to move out, but the brother is going to entertain you with his wonderful poetry as you leave. Come on up, Joshua, and they'll be quiet.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you. You were way amazing.
Okay, that's kind of weird. I guess I'll perform for like you guys right here then. Just as we close out.
Nice to see you.
Actually, is it cool if everybody just sort of like gives me your attention for just like 3 minutes? Is that fine? Thank you guys. Okay. Yeah, because there's just one thing I really wanted to touch on really quick. So this last piece I'm going to do for you guys is about Stevie Wonder. And part of what I really took away from the panel that really touched my heart is something I felt like was hinted at but not really touched upon strongly was kids with disabilities, and that there's this whole population of people in the United States that are caught in the education gap in a way that we don't even really have a proper understanding of. And this last piece was inspired by Stevie Wonder, and about this last year I spent in England being part of a ministry where we went every single week and we would play with kids with disabilities just in an attempt to like just show them God's love and remind them, like as part of what Diane was talking about, that each of them are beautiful and just need to be cared for. So this piece is an open letter to Stevie Wonder, and I hope you guys just enjoy it and rock with me as we go. Dear Stevie, you are the only musician that my father ever talks about. Tells me that back when he fought in Vietnam, he would listen to your song "For Once in My Life" on repeat. Says that against the backdrop of all that destruction, it reminded him of how much he loved being alive. The first time I saw you live, my veins turned to jumper cables. The air was so thick with laughter that I could barely move. A woman seated just one row in front of me, draped in a whole different genre of beautiful and dancing, like her entire body was a playground, perfectly designed for her bones to double dutch in. It was that sort of night. Our bodies came unhinged, split like the kiss of axe blade and timber the moment your fingertips glided across that triton. The keys turned to keys, and suddenly the stadium was no stadium at all, but a dance hall in 1970s Georgia. You, once again a 13-year-old boy, harmonica blooming from your lips, Jim Crow weeping at the back of the venue, unable to breathe once you let all that flame in your throat go free. Every time you sing the word sunshine, I rethink what it means to see. Figure it must be something even more grand than the split second waltz between iris and light that so many of us take for granted. When I was 9, you told me that rainbows were ribbons in the sky, which led me to believe that the heavens must be a gift, the sunrise just a billion birthday candles set to blaze whenever the sun was born anew from the womb of the sea. You can't just say things like that to kids. It makes them dream, carves their world into a canvas where every shade of human is acceptable, where my little brother, diagnosed with autism at age 3, can sit at a drum set and coax the thunder from its belly until it speaks twice as loudly as all those voices that told us to focus on what he could not do, where every other week I can sit in a classroom an hour outside of London and be reminded by a group of teenagers with disabilities that they are made in God's image too, that our bodies are not chained to what this world says about how we should work. I have always been told that the eyes are the windows to the soul, but maybe your soul is a window for our eyes. Every song, like a beautiful mirror, perfectly placed at the corners of your mind. The one thing I know for sure about the wedding that I hope to have someday is that I want your music to be played the moment I see my bride. Your dress, billowing behind her like a waterfall made of silk, the chorus, isn't she lovely, filling the sanctuary like a gentle mist. My father, seated in the front row, reciting every word from memory, and smiling the way a man only can when he has seen death and come away dancing. Thank you for the hits, my friend, for the way you abused your gift. I lift a glass to you.